Champagne. Even the word itself has a ring of luxury to it. Like you could curl up inside it and find yourself surrounded by whispers and glitter and fine downy pillows. It brings to mind images of pale gold glasses, dark black dresses, and smiles so wide they make your cheeks hurt. It's a symbol so ingrained in our culture that you might not have realized it was a symbol at all. Popping the cork on a bottle of champagne is just what you do when it's time to celebrate. A wedding, a new year, or a ship's maiden journey. But how did this bubbly French wine come to symbolize such glamorous celebration? Well, since time immemorial, wine has always been a step above other alcoholic beverages. It's more expensive and rarer than drinks like beer, and over time has become refined, elegant, and complex. Nowadays, you can get a cheap Trader Joe's bottle for $3 or $4, sure, but everyone has heard of, seen, or, the lucky ones, tasted, a bottle that goes for $100, $500, $1,000, or more. We're not the only time period to value wine. For example, it was used in France to celebrate during the coronation of kings going back centuries. In the 18th century, many French nobles started preferring sparkling wine, which made our favorite champagne a sought-after favorite. The word champagne comes from the Champagne area in France and is derived from the Latin word campagna, or campagna, referring to the open fields and countryside of the area. Great place for a vineyard. For a long time, the wine from Champagne was no better or worse than any other, but Champagne itself got a boost above the rest in the Industrial Revolution. Better technology allowed Champagne production to grow and grow, and a successful marketing campaign made Champagne seem more luxurious and special than other wines. Famous actors and painters were hired to make art about Champagne and show the public how lovely and special the wine really was. This was only heightened when a Phylloxera insect outbreak damaged and killed off many Champagne vineyards, causing Champagne supply to dwindle at the same time demand skyrocketed. Prices raised, rarity increased, and before long, even getting your hands on a bottle was only possible for the richest of the rich. Plus, some controversy with people growing grapes outside the Champagne area resulted in the famous law that dictates only bubbling wine from Champagne itself is allowed to call itself true champagne. Obviously, this in and of itself means champagne is rare, and, even with the rich, ought to be reserved for special occasions. All this helps to establish champagne's symbolization of the good life, to which the growing 20th century middle class and the elite class could aspire. If you could afford champagne, it meant you had made it to a life of decadent indulgence. As the author of The Great Gatsby, F. Scott Fitzgerald, once commented, "Too much of anything is bad, but too much champagne is just right." Champagne was expensive and rare, so having it meant you were rich and classy, or at least you looked rich and classy. Having a lot of it, perhaps even enough to waste some of it by spraying it around after popping the cork, meant you were decadent, bourgeois, the epitome of the 1920s. By World War II, champagne wasn't just for the luxurious, but a loved treasure of everybody. Winston Churchill once motivated the British forces with the claim, "Remember, gentlemen, it's not just France we are fighting for, it's champagne." After the war, it returned to its decadent place of honor, notably being a favored drink of James Bond when he isn't enjoying shaken martinis. Also, Marilyn Monroe was rumored to have taken a bath in 350 bottles of champagne. Whether true or not, the story succeeds in drawing from our cultural symbolism of champagne being something of luxury and richness. For Marilyn Monroe to have had enough champagne to bathe in truly must mean she is the elite of the elite, which is exactly what they wanted you to think with that story. Nowadays, we still treat champagne as a treasure, as a mode of celebration for our most special events. We gift bottles at graduations. We still show our decadence by spraying it around on sports coaches, for instance, after a big win. We still toast with champagne at weddings, and we even still break a bottle for christening new ships and planes, a tradition thought to start by replicating the consumption of champagne at a baby's christening. And, of course, we pop a cork at midnight to christen in a new year. From all of us here at Classics and Chill, we hope you have a wonderful new year. May 2022 bring you many, many reasons to break out a bottle of bubbly. Cheers!